This is a really tricky film because I didn't know what we were going to uncover, right? But I did want to honor the family and Detective Souter.
I just finished watching the doc for a second time, and I was just kind of equally, I think, puzzled, especially by the end. I didn't really know how I actually feel about what I believe happened in that case. And it left me with so many questions for you. Mm-hmm. And the first one is, why this particular story, when there are so many to choose from, I would imagine, even centered in Baltimore?
You know, an executive from HBO brought this to me, Carrie Antholis. And initially, I wasn't sure it was this story that I wanted to tell, or I was right to tell. I was the right person to actually direct. But after the development period, there seemed to be an opportunity here to use this larger case, which I thought was going to remain a mystery, to make some other points. And I think I thought that through the way the Baltimore Police Department would handle this case and the family would somehow make a statement on how, on the impact that they had on the city and the public at large. So I felt like there was an opportunity for a microcosmic story to mirror a macrocosmic sort of impact that we really needed to look at. I wasn't sure that was going to happen, but I felt that there was a possibility for that. And I thought it was an important case because this was a Black man, and he was law enforcement. And that's an intersection that we haven't seen, you know, or we haven't, I'm sure it's out there, but we haven't seen a lot of narratives around, you know, what happens when a Black man who's a law enforcement officer dies, and the public thinks, you know, one of the theories is that it could be at the hands of his quote unquote brethren or the police. So I thought that was also interesting. Great question.
I thought that was so interesting too. And very early in the doc, we kind of see even that explored, like, wait, why would the people of this city who are constantly abused by the police department there care so much, so passionately, that there was an officer down and, you know, there may be a lie there? And then someone very early in the doc puts it into context, saying if they would do this to their own, you know, if they would do this to a police officer, what does that say about what they would do to us? And I was really struck by that, and that almost realizing that the people there have to resort to even that far to get people to really pay attention to how corrupt this particular police department in this particular city has been for so long.
Yeah, you know, it was so important to have the voices of the people, you know, especially someone like Dee Watkins, who I consider, and I think many people in Baltimore to consider to be, you know, a true son of Baltimore, you know, someone who was born and raised there and has had quite a journey there and has seen, has had a variety of experiences there and can truly be an authentic voice and an authority. So when he says something like that, I think it definitely carries weight.
Yes. I also found myself, you know, embarrassingly realizing that much of what I know or think I know about what happens in Baltimore between the police and its citizens comes from all of the Wire episodes that I ever watched. You know, that's kind of like my foundation in my head. I'm from LA, and that's the reference I got. And as I was watching this film, I found myself picturing this case like an episode of The Wire and thinking of all of the possible ways and reasons that this could have happened. And I wonder, for you, as someone who spent so much time on, you know, the fictional and now the non-fictional sides of what's really happening in Baltimore, where do you land on, I guess, Do you think that the world, do you think that the country is finally hearing and finally paying attention to the corruption that continues to plague all police departments, but especially the Baltimore Police Department?
You know, I know it might be hard to believe for some folks, you know, but I do believe there is attention being paid. I mean, there's so much media out here around police corruption. You know, I've never told anyone this story, but I remember when my father got out of the service, he retired back in the late 60s, in our town, he was one of the first Black guards at the jail. And he got into a lot of trouble when he saw police brutality, like brutality within the jail. And he started reporting it. Eventually he got fired. But this was something that was, you know, in my world in a way, you know, gosh, I hadn't thought about this in years. And no one knew about this. You know, my father was giving me these stories, but folks, you know what I mean? And there were people listening, but compared to what, you know, the people of my father's generation had to endure and you know, in the ways they weren't heard. And now I'm saying, yeah, there has been some evolution for sure. Just got to keep pushing. Yes. Just a slow hustle, like Dee said.
Yes, absolutely. I wonder, for someone who's been, you know, played such pivotal roles on the screen and been able to kind of translate that to work behind the screen, what is it as a director? Like, what do you think informs your vision as a director, and what from your career as an actor informs the lens that you're telling stories through now?
You know, just this, you know, documentary, you know, specifically, there is just something about getting to the heart of the truth of the matter. And then also creating something that is also meant to inspire reflection. And at the same time, I have to be so enamored by the subject and passionate about the subject. The subject has to be something, you know, or the theme, or, you know, whatever it is, you know, it has to be something that I also need to be enlightened about as well. I need to be able to learn something. I need to be going on a journey with the folks that are in the film. I need to have something to contribute. So I think in terms of direction of documentary, it's this sort of, I have an attraction to telling a story with a group of people and having a sort of an overall vision and something that's guiding me internally. And then working with a team, you know, to create a structure that is flexible and breathes so that together, you know, we're all seeing, making sure that we're seeing the truth, reflecting a truth, and the truth is reflecting something back at us that maybe we didn't expect, and then allowing that to actually be a part of the thing that is being created through the group. And so that's what I like about documentary filmmaking and filmmaking in general. I'm sure, you know, I mean, it has all those qualities. Art and creativity in general has those qualities, but narrative filmmaking, you come with a script. Everybody they're locked into certain, you know, aspects of the day that you can't veer off of, or, you know, you don't have a whole lot of room to, you know, to jump and play. You know, you do, you know, as the creative in there, but not as much as I think you do with documentary. Although documentary is based on actually really trying to capture the truth and the essence of truth. And the essence of truth has many different aspects to it. It has dark and light and shadow, you know, yes, and context. And so, yeah, I mean, that's what gets me excited about documentary directing.
What was the hardest thing, if anything, to leave on the cutting room floor for this?
Oh, gosh. The more detailed journey of the family. I felt like, just being able to show a little bit more of the glue, I think, between, you know, it's like trying to, you know, I think it was just finding that balance between having to establish the corruption, you know, how deep the corruption was in the city, in the police department there, and the ways that Sean actually was, you know, around that corruption or had touched, you know, certain people. He was a part of the police department, you know? And so all the little bits that we had to reveal as the story went on sort of, you know, started to crowd out a little bit of what I like to call like the heart and soul, you know, of a documentary, of any documentary I would like to make, at least at this point, but just that where we really see the family going from being totally behind the cops, you know, and being patient to then making that sharp left turn, right? There was, I think, a little bit more, you know, sort of glue there that we weren't able to include, you know, which you can see in the extra content. Mm-hmm. So hopefully, you know, that'll be fun, you know, for folks to check out online.